Hey, Thursday Nighters, good to see you guys. Let's stand together. Lord, we thank you that we can rally together once again and open your word. Lord, see what, Lord, you've instructed us concerning life and godliness. Lord, you've spoken to us very clearly, Lord, in the power of your inspired and infallible word. Just everything we need. And tonight, Lord, as we look into the future and see what your word says concerning the millennial kingdom, Lord, we're excited that you've called us to be a part of your kingdom and that you call us your own. And you're just a great and awesome God. We're here to worship you. We're here to learn of you. We're here to grow in grace and grow in the knowledge of Jesus. And so we bless you and we sing out our praise to you tonight, Lord. Thank you for loving us like you do. Oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! And when I think that God, his Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation, take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. All the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light. Darkness tries to hide. Trembles at his voice. Trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. Age to age he stands, time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, and Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. How great is our God. You're the name above all names. You're the name above all names. Worthy of our praise. My heart will sing. How great is our God. You're the name above all names. How great is our God? How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God? One more time. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great our God. Oh, we'll see how great is our God.
Amen. Right on. You guys can have a seat, and glad you're here tonight and looking forward to getting in the Word with you, and we're going to jump right in. So put your seatbelts on. We're going to cruise through a lot of Scripture tonight. And so I just encourage you, as we venture into really looking at what God's Word says concerning the millennial kingdom, and that is that time that you and I are going to rule and reign with Christ on earth for 1,000 years, following the second coming, not to be confused with the rapture of the church. We are living in the moment right now, according to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, that we are living in this any moment rapture opportunity. In other words, the Lord could take us to be with him at any moment. There's nothing prophetically that needs to transpire before the church is violently taken away to meet the Lord in the air, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Not to, again, be confused with the second coming, and that's the time when Christ returns with all of his saints. That's you and I. After we have gathered together for that great and wonderful wedding supper of the Lamb in heaven, and then we return with Christ at the second coming. And when that time comes, there's going to be an ushering in of what we know of, according to the scriptures, all through the prophets as the millennial kingdom. That millennial meaning 1,000-year reign with Christ. And so we're going to look at that tonight. A lot of it refers to the fulfillment of God's kingdom concerning Israel. And so the millennial kingdom is that 1,000-year time frame following the second coming of Christ, where you and I and all of the tribulation saints and all of the saints of old are going to be ruling and reigning with Christ on earth. And I'm going to read to you where that's clearly pointed out in Revelation chapter 20. And so you're going to have to note down a lot of scriptures. I'm going to read a lot of scriptures tonight. And you'll just have to note them. Some of them I'm going to just give you the references to, okay? So you just have to note them. But this is a really thick teaching, but it's riddled with scripture because you got to know what the prophets say concerning the millennial kingdom. But let me start with what John says in Revelation chapter 20 concerning this 1,000-year reign of Christ on the earth. It says in Revelation chapter 20, I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold of the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years and cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal upon him that he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years should be fulfilled. And after that, he must be loosed a little season. So at the end of that 1,000 years, where Satan, the devil, is bound for 1,000 years, he's going to be given opportunity where he will be loosed for a little season. Verse 4, and I saw thrones and they that sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus. That's during the great tribulation time. Those tribulation saints that were martyred for their faith in Christ, they were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ, how long? 1,000 years, a millennia. But the rest of the dead lived not again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he that is part of this first resurrection. On such the second death has no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him again 1,000 years. And so we right now, this day, are living in the any moment rapture of the church. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. Very clearly, there's coming a time where you and I are going to be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. And when that transpires, all living believers and the dead who will precede us will be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. At that point, the stopwatch of the great tribulation is going to start, that time of Jacob's trouble that Daniel talks about. The stopwatch begins, and at that point, there's 7 years beginning at that moment, triggered by the rapture of the church and the revelation of the Antichrist, which is going to take place in that simultaneous time. Somewhere in there, there's a time frame there. The rapture, the revelation of the Antichrist, beginning the great tribulation, where God is going to pour out his wrath upon those who have rejected him. It's a time of judgment. It's a time of wrath. It's a time of the opening of the seals and the pouring out of the bowls of judgment that we read about in Revelation chapter 6 through 19. And that is a time where God is pouring out his judgment, his righteous indignation on a Christ-rejecting world. Now, you and I, in my belief, in my understanding of the scriptures, we will not be here during that time of tribulation. Why? Well, first of all, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, we've been raptured. Okay? Secondly, if you go into 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, or if you continue on, you see that there is no judgment for the believer, for we have already been judged in Christ, right? That's the whole beauty of the cross. The wrath of God towards sin has already been poured out on Christ. So we are not children of wrath, we're children of grace. We're not under the wrath of God. And that's why you hear me so often say, as a believer, God's not mad at you. He's not disappointed. He's not angry. He's not frustrated or whatever I might say. He's not. Why? Because that's all been taken care of, right? That's the beauty, one of billions, the beauty of the cross. And so the rapture takes place. The Antichrist is revealed. The tribulation time, the great tribulation begins, and that culminates, and there's a lot in between the beginning and the end there, and we've been through the book of Revelation, but it culminates in that great battle of Armageddon, Revelation chapter 19. See this grand battle there in the plains of Megiddo there. And that climaxes with the second coming of Christ, where Christ will return on this earth. He's coming and returning to this earth right here, this very ground that we stand upon. And he will touch ground there on the Mount of Olives, in which time the mountain will split. And Christ then has returned, but not coming now as a suffering servant, not coming as a babe in swaddling clothes lying in a manger. He is coming as the King of Kings. He is coming as the Lord of Lords. He is coming to establish justice. He is coming to bring in fully his kingdom of truth and righteousness. Everything that the world is screaming for in their present political system and cannot find it anywhere, and it never will be found in a political system run by man. For man ultimately is corrupted by power. Not that we shouldn't be involved, not that we shouldn't be ministering God's grace and trying to execute justice upon this earth, but at the end of the day, it is only the conquering king who can bring in his kingdom fully. And at that time, Satan is bound, as we just read in Revelation chapter 20, he is bound for 1,000 years. And then at the very end of that time, he'll be loosed to try to deceive once again for a short time, and we'll look at that. And all those that choose his deception, even at the end of the time of the millennial kingdom where Christ is here physically, there are those that are glorified, there are those that are unglorified, living here, ruling and reigning. Israel is restored. Jerusalem is the hub of the world. It's an incredible event that takes place, but even in that, there are still many that will shake their fist at God. And at the end of that 1,000 years, those that have chosen Satan's deceptions will be burned in the lake of fire and cast therein, Satan included. And you can read more about that in Revelation chapter 7. Actually, I'll read it to you. It says, "And when the 1,000 years are expired," Revelation 27, "Satan is going to be loosed out of his prison, and he shall go out to deceive the nations which are on the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog." You've heard about that as the prophets have spoken. Gog is the ruler, Magog, the people of the north, I believe, that will eventually come down and have battle with Israel, trying to take the oil of Israel in my estimation. "And they're going to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. And they went up on the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about and the beloved city. And fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. And then I saw a great white throne. This is that great white throne judgment. And him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And it says, and the books were opened. Notice it says the books, plural. Revelation 20, verse 12. Books are opened. And then another book, singular. So there's books, and then there's a book that was opened, which is the book of life. So there's one book. That's the one that we've got to have our names in. And if you have faith in Christ, your name is written in the book of life. And those that were not in the book of life, they were in the other books. They were judged out of those things which were written in the books, each man according to their works. In other words, God is a righteous judge. He will judge rightly. In other words, the punishment will fit the crime. Every man individually judged, each man according to his works. And to the degree that man violates the holiness of God, to that same perfect, exacting degree, his wrath will be poured out upon that individual. And I saw the dead and small stand before God. The books were open. I just read that in verse 13. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged, every man, again, according to their works. And that's why I believe that, yes, there are, not all sin is the same. Yes, all sin separates us from God. All sin places judgment upon us. The slightest violation of God's holiness separates us from God eternally and damns us to hell. The slightest of sin. We're born into it. The psalmist said we are conceived in sin. It's been imparted to us. It's been imputed to us. We've inherited it from the very beginning, since the fall of humanity. But it says here that every man is judged according to their works. And that's why I believe that there are levels of judgment. Now, I don't say there's levels of hell, because there's nothing in the scriptures that indicate that. But there are levels of judgment, because each man is being judged according to his works. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. And at that point, at the end of that dispensation of the millennial kingdom, that time frame that the word talks about, that ushers in another dispensation we didn't talk about, but that would be the eternal age. And that's the time that where God makes everything new, including the earth and the heavens. Revelation 21, verse 1, it says, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, and for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. This is when the new Jerusalem descends down out of heaven, and it is the perfect, beautiful, eternal paradise for all believers. Revelation chapter 20, verse 10 and following describes that new Jerusalem that comes out of heaven, and it's just this incredible perfection of paradise, whatever that looks like, I don't know. I mean, there's a little bit of detail on how that's all shapes up in the scriptures, but scripture says a lot concerning this time frame of the millennial kingdom that we're going to look at tonight. And if you've placed your faith in Christ, evidenced by action, then you will be ruling and reigning with Jesus during this 1,000-year time frame of just unprecedented peace, unprecedented prosperity, according to the prophets. So we're going to look at a few of those. I told you last week we'd go through 25 of them. I really doubt we're going to get through those. But we'll start here. Here's some scriptures concerning promises about that 1,000-year time frame. Okay? Now, you and I are going to be there, so we should take note. Okay? We're going to be there. That's going to happen. It could happen, I mean, it could happen tomorrow, in a sense, when you're raptured out of this earth. And you say, well, they've been saying that for a lot of years. Yeah, true, but we are closer to the truth than they are. Because every day that goes by gets us closer to that moment of the rapture. So could that happen in our generation? Absolutely. Could it happen tonight? Yeah, it could. And when that takes place,
we enter into a timeless place called heaven. There is no space and time as we would know it now. When we enter into heaven, it's heaven. We're not waiting around for our loved ones to get there. It's all the eternal present, the eternal now. Oftentimes I encourage people who've lost loved ones, letting them know your loved one is not waiting around for you to get there. They're not bummed out, separated from you. The moment they entered the heavens, you entered right with them. Boom, right then and there. Even though we're in time here and maybe years go by here in heaven, there is no time. And so that takes place. And then, boom, we return with Christ at the second coming, post the great tribulation. And so what happens during that 1,000 years after the Satan is bound and thrown into the lake of fire? And the great white throne judgment has taken place, and there's that 1,000 years, if you would, or actually that happens at the end. Well, number one, there's always, as you know, through scriptures, there's always a remnant of Israel. No matter how many times they were cut down, no matter how many times they have been, you know, there's been attempts on annihilating the population of Israel. Not just historic, not just ancient history, but even recent history. In the last generation or so, you know, there's always an attack against Israel. And they've been under this great oppression and horrific Holocaust. There's been an incredible hatred for God's people from the very beginning of time. Well, in the millennial kingdom, that remnant of Israel, there's always a remnant. They're going to be restored and they're going to be saved. Romans chapter 9, 10, and 11. You can read about that. Isaiah chapter 1, Amos chapter 9, Zechariah chapter 13. I'll read just a few of these. Hosea chapter 4. I know I'm going fast. Joel chapter 2, Ezekiel 36. It just goes on and on and on and on. But that remnant of Israel is going to be restored. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 26 through 28 says this. I'll read it. It says, I, Yahweh speaking, I will restore your judges as at the first, and your counselors as at the beginning. And after that, you will be called the city of righteousness, a faithful city. Zion, Israel, will be redeemed with justice, and her repentant ones with righteousness. But transgressors and sinners will be crushed together, and those who forsake the Lord will come to an end. So there's this redemption, there's this restoration, there's this salvation of Israel. Micah chapter 7, verses 19 and 20, it says this, he will again have compassion on us. The prophet, the minor prophet Micah is speaking, God's going to have compassion on us, and he will tread our iniquities underfoot, and you will cast all their sins into the depths of the sea. And you will give truth to Israel and unchanging love to Abraham, which you swore to our forefathers from the days of old. That's going to happen in this time of the millennial kingdom where Israel will be saved. Israel will be restored. Number two, this same remnant of Israel. And a lot of this applies to Israel, by the way. And there's a reason for that. We'll get to that at the very end if we get there. The remnant of Israel is going to come to a place of finally recognizing that Christ was the Messiah. They're going to come to this recognition where they have rejected the Messiah. They've rejected Christ, and there's going to be this great repentance and this great regret. Oh, man, we missed it. The Word talks about that. I don't know if you've been to Israel. I've been talking to some friends again recently about perhaps making a journey over there with us, whoever would want to go. How many of you guys want to go to Israel? That'd be great. How many of you guys would actually go to Israel if we actually... Okay, that'd be awesome. And so I've been working on putting together a hands-on trip over to Israel where we're actually going to raft the Jordan River and we're going to climb up Masada and we're going to sea kayak in the Sea of Galilee. It's going to be a real hands-on type of trip. But anyway, we'll talk about that later. But this remnant of Israel, they're gonna finally recognize, man, Christ was it. He was the Messiah. I've been there at the Western Wall before And I've talked with some of the Orthodox Jews that were there, and they've come up and they've handed me these flyers, and they said, we found the Messiah. It's Rabbi, you know, Itzik, whoever, you know, and you know, Cohen or whoever it might be. And they're so excited because they feel like their rabbi is the Messiah. Well, they missed it. Christ is the Messiah. He is the Mashiach. He is the Christos. He is the one
that has come to save his people from their sin. And there will be a recognition of that. In Isaiah chapter 1, verse 29, it says this, "You," Yahweh speaking, "you will be ashamed of the oaks which you have desired." And the oaks is that the strength and the power that you've desired. "You will be embarrassed at the gardens which you have chosen, the leisure and the comfort. For you will be like an oak whose leaves fade away, and as a garden that has no water, and the strong man will become tender, and his work will also a spark. Thus they shall both burn together, and there'll be none to quench them." There's going to be this regret. "Oh, I missed it. I was seeking after other things," concerning Israel, concerning the Jewish people in general. Zechariah chapter 12 says this, "I'm going to pour out on the house of David and on the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and of supplication, so that they will look on me whom they have pierced, and they will mourn for him." They're going to see him, you know, for who he is. And we know that when we see Christ, we are going to see him as a lamb having been slain. In other words, Jesus bears the scars of his crucifixion even now. If you remember, Thomas, the one that would not believe, came and said to the other disciples who told him that, you know, Christ had resurrected, and he said, "I will not believe unless I see him and I thrust my hand into his side and I see his scars." And if you remember, when Jesus finally did appear to Thomas, Thomas touched him, put his hand in his side, his scars are there, and he bowed down and said, "My Lord and my God." And that was Jesus in his glorified state. He had resurrected from the dead. He was glorified. And he forever bears the scars. And so they will see him during that millennial kingdom, and they will mourn for him as one mourns for an only son. And they will weep bitterly over him like the bitter weeping over a firstborn. And in that day, there will be great mourning in Jerusalem. Number three, Jerusalem will be lifted up spiritually and topographically. There is going to be a rising of the earth around Jerusalem. They're of bringing Jerusalem up topographically. It says in Isaiah chapter 2, verses 2 and 3, and some believe that this is just a figure of speech. I believe that there's nothing that indicates this to be a figure of speech, so I take it, as we've learned, literally. Okay? In Isaiah chapter 2, it says this, it's going to come about that in the last days, the mountain of the house of the Lord will be established as the chief of the mountains and will be raised above the hills. By the way, this is the scripture that we ended up planting Mountain Church upon. That in that last day, the time of the millennial kingdom, this mountain of the house of the Lord is going to be established as a chief among the mountains and will be raised above the hills, and all the nations are going to stream to it, and many people will come and say, "Come, let us go to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us concerning his ways." Why? Because he will be here physically on earth. Let's go see Jesus. How awesome would that be? Then if I said, anybody want to go to Israel? Everybody. It's like, yeah, I'm in. Right? Because Jesus is going to be there. He's going to be teach us concerning his ways, that we may walk in his paths. For the law will go forth from Israel, from Jerusalem, and the word of the Lord, literally, the word of the Lord coming out of Jerusalem. The word of Jesus coming out of Jerusalem. Micah chapter 4, verses 1 and 2 says, in essence, the exact same thing. You can look those scriptures up. Number 4. Concerning the millennial kingdom, Jesus, as we said earlier, is going to come and rule as king. He's going to come and rule as judge, and he's going to rule as a just ruler. Isaiah chapter 2, Isaiah chapter 9, Isaiah chapter 11. Just read the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 33. And Micah, again, chapter 2. Isaiah 2, 4, it says this, "And he will judge between the nations and will render decisions for many peoples."
Isaiah 9, 6, and 7, one that you know well. For unto us a child is born, a son is going to be given to us, and the government will rest upon his shoulders. When a government rests upon the shoulders of one in a kingdom, that's the king. And his name is going to be called Wonderful Counselor and Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. And there will be no end to the increase of his government or of his peace. And on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and uphold it with justice and righteousness from then on and forevermore. And the zeal of the Lord is going to be that which accomplishes this. God is going to accomplish his purposes concerning Israel, concerning us, concerning his kingdom. Micah chapter 4, it says, many are going to come and say, come and let us go to the mountain of the Lord. Basically, it's what I read earlier in Isaiah chapter 2. Number 5, another thing that's going to happen during the millennial kingdom, you and I will be there. And you're thinking, well, this is all pertaining to Israel. When are we going to get to the good stuff? Well, we're getting there, okay? So number 5, Jesus is going to put an end to war. And he's going to establish eternal peace. He is going to bring an end to war. There will be no more war. There will be no more fighting. There will be no more international conflagrations. There will be no more need for, there's no need presently for the United Nations, but there will be no need in the future for the United Nations. That was my political bent. Sorry, it snuck out. Happens. There's not going to be any hatred towards one another. Isaiah 42 says this concerning the millennial kingdom. Behold, my servant whom I uphold, my chosen one, God speaking of his own son, in whom my soul delights. I put my spirit upon him, and he will bring forth justice to the nations. He will not cry out or raise his voice, nor make his voice heard in the street. A bruised reed he will not break, and a dimly burning wick he will not extinguish. He will faithfully bring forth justice. He will not be disheartened or crushed until he has established justice in the earth, and the coastlands will wait expectantly for his law. Isaiah chapter 2, verse 4b. It says, and they will hammer their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. They're not going to need their spears. They're not going to need their swords any longer. In other words, weapons. There won't be a need to have any defensive weapons. Nation will not lift up its sword against nation. There will be no more. And it says, and never again will they learn war. Isaiah chapter 2, verse 4. They will never again, humanity will never again learn warfare. There will be no more, you know, situation rooms. There will be no more strategy concerning warfare. It'll be over. Violence, Isaiah chapter 60, will not be heard again in your land, nor devastation, nor destruction with any of your borders. But you will call your walls salvation. You're going to call your gates praise. It's just going to be a time of unprecedented peace, like the world has never known. Because the king is going to establish justice. The King of Kings is going to be the one that is governing. He's going to be on the throne, at the helm. Not some, you know, lackey human. No matter how great a human is, we are so incredibly far removed from what justice really looks like. And we are so incredibly removed from what righteousness and holiness really looks like, but not Christ. He is the very essence of these things, and violence will not be heard in your land. And Zechariah, the prophet Zechariah in chapter 9 says this, I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the horse from Jerusalem, and the bow of war will be broken. And Jesus will speak peace to the nations.
And his dominion will be from sea to sea and from river to the ends of the earth. In other words, it's a global kingdom in which God will reign. Christ will rule. Number six, concerning the millennial kingdom, this remnant of the Jew, this remnant of Israel, we talked about earlier just a little bit that they will be saved, they will be made holy, and they will become great renown or great, they will have a great reputation throughout the earth. Can you imagine? The Jew who is hated, anti-Semitism once again on the rise. They've been underfoot. They've been on the run for thousands of years. On May 14th, 1948, they were finally given a little speck of the land that God had given them, but they finally, once again, were able to call a piece of land their own. And there they are fighting on every border against invasion and hatred and rockets firing in from Hamas. And I mean, there's this massive, you know, warfare taking place across their all of their border. But God says there's coming a time where you are going to be envied. The world will want to be you. Right now, the world wants to drive them into the sea. I'm proud of our country making a decision to honor Israel's right to claim Jerusalem as their capital. I'm grateful, no matter what side of the political fence you may sit on, man, I am grateful that our commander-in-chief presently has chosen to no longer kick the can down the road and say, you know what? We're putting our embassy in Jerusalem. And of course, that sparks all kinds of hatred. But you can know what greatness looks like by the caliber of your enemies. And so I'm encouraged when I see all of the countries that are so opposed to us placing our capital or our embassy in Jerusalem. And I'm like, okay, those are the enemies I want to have. Yeah, I don't want to be friends with them. They hate Israel, and they hate the great Satan, the United States. Anyway, it's coming out again. So, anyway, number seven. Actually, I didn't read any scriptures on that, but you guys can read through that. Isaiah chapter 4, once again. The book of Isaiah has so much to say about the millennial kingdom, but Isaiah chapter 4 concerning Israel having great, great renown in the world. It says, in that day, the branch of the Lord, Isaiah chapter 4, verse 2 and following, the branch of the Lord will be beautiful and glorious, and the fruit of the earth will be the pride and the adornment of the survivors of Israel. And it will come about that he who is left in Zion and remains in Jerusalem will be called holy, and everyone who is recorded for life in Jerusalem. Man, they're going to be called holy. Isaiah chapter 25, he will swallow up death for all time, and the Lord God will wipe tears away from all faces, and he will remove the reproach of his people. He's going to remove the hatred of Israel from all the earth, for the Lord God has spoken. I like that one. This reproach, this hatred of God's chosen people is going to be removed. And it goes on in chapter 61 of Isaiah and says, and their offspring will be known among the nations, and their descendants in the midst of the peoples, and all who see them will recognize them, because they are the offspring whom the Lord has blessed. And so during the millennial kingdom, when you're kicking around, you're going to see God's chosen people, you're going to see Israel, you're going to see a Jew, and you're going to be like, hey, you're one of God's blessed people. I mean, we're blessed too, but you, oh man, the stuff you guys went through, but God fulfilled his promise to his people, and he has blessed you. Number seven, concerning the millennial kingdom, Jerusalem is going to be a refuge because of God's supernatural blessing and protection. God is going to supernaturally bless and supernaturally protect his people. Oh, the scriptures are just, again, if you're writing these down, I know you're getting a fraction of them, but Isaiah chapter 2, chapter 11, chapter 32, and chapter 62. Just concerning the blessing and the supernatural protection that God is placing upon Jerusalem. Zechariah chapter 8, I'm going to read that one. Zechariah chapter 8, verse 3, it says this. Thus saith the Lord, I will return to Zion, and I will dwell in the midst of Jerusalem. This is Jesus, right? He's going to return to Zion. He's going to return. He's going to be in Jerusalem, right in the midst. Back in that same place that we read about in the Gospels, where he's confronting the Pharisees. He'll be walking around Jerusalem. It was right over there. That's where I was put into that grave that I rose from. And it was right up there. That's where I was crucified. And he's going to be walking around in Jerusalem. The city of truth is what it's going to be called. And the mountain of the Lord of hosts will be called the holy mountain. So Jerusalem is going to be called the city of truth. Because the way and the truth and the life will abide there. Number 8. There will no longer be divided territory in Israel. Israel will get all the land that was promised to them. This is going to happen during the millennial kingdom. All the land that God had promised to Israel, they will have it and more. In Isaiah chapter 9, it says, there will be no more gloom for her who was in anguish. In earlier times, he treated the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali with content. But later on, he shall make it glorious by the way of the sea on the other side of Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. In Isaiah 26, it goes on. It says, you have increased the nation, O Lord. You have increased the nation. You are glorified, and you've extended all the borders of the land. And this is all in reference to the millennial kingdom. They will ultimately, finally possess the land without any, you know, need for the iron wall. You know, no need to have a massive border around their borders to stop the rockets from coming in. By the thousands and thousands and thousands. They literally have, oh my goodness, since 1948, the number of rockets that have been launched into Jerusalem and Tel Aviv, but it is astronomical, the number that Hamas has launched in there and others. And all of the borders of their land are going to be extended, Isaiah chapter 26. Number 9, and this one, I love this one. I mean, I love them all, but this is awesome. Creation is going to be at peace with itself and with humanity. Creation is going to be in harmony, and the curse is going to be reversed. The curse, I mean, think about that. The curse. Everything that is cursed, which is everything, is going to be reversed. You don't be fighting over stuff. Why? Because you're not going to be living in pride. You're going to worship freely without distraction. Why? Because you're not going to be concerned about material things. You're going to live with unbelievable prosperity and health because there is no more disease. There is no more sickness. Danny, you're out of a job. Just going to be able to worship and sing praises to God. Unprecedented. A reversing of the curse. Pardon me. And creation will be at peace with itself and with humanity. It says in Isaiah chapter 11. You notice that most of it, so much of this is in Isaiah. So much of Isaiah is a reference to the millennial kingdom. It says in Isaiah chapter 11, verses 6 through 9, the wolf will dwell with the lamb or lie down with the lamb. That's good news for me. Most of my lambs that I raise get taken by cougars or coyotes. The leopard is going to lie down with the young goat, and the calf of the young lion and the fatling together, and the little boy will lead them, and the cow and the bear will graze. They will become herbivores. And their young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like an ox. And the nursing child will play by the hole of the cobra, and the weaned child will put his hand in the viper's den, and they will not hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Unprecedented peace. Isaiah 55 says this, "For you will go out with joy, you'll be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills will break forth into shouts of joy before you, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. Instead of the thorn bush, the cypress will come up. And instead of the nettle, the myrtle will come up. And it will be a memorial to the Lord for an everlasting sign which will never be cut off." There's a healing of the earth, of creation, and it will once again and be harmony. I mean, can you imagine? I mean, if you like creation, which I hope you do, I hope you're Oregonians, you know, unless you're transplants, and if you are, you need to get out and enjoy the beauty of our wonderful, beautiful, you know, God-blessed Northwest. I mean, we have the most incredible place. I mean, this is, it's just epic. Right here, right in our backyard. I was over in Bend again this last week, and the week before on the Oregon coast with a bunch of warrior dudes. One of the coolest weekends of my life. I had a great time with these guys. But last weekend over in Bend, and I mean, just, you know, just get in your car and take a drive off I-5 somewhere. And man, it is the most epic. But that's in its fallen state. You see the water just gushing through the gorge, you know, an hour away. And that's in its fallen state. You see Crater Lake and it's just epic blue. That's in its fallen state. That's like a mud hole compared to what it could be in its reversed state, in its reversed curse state. You look at the waterfalls of Yosemite, or you just look at the beauty of our own backyard and the mountains around here. And the epic mountain biking trails, and just, I mean, everything that, you know, that's all in its fallen state, and it's going to be reversed. And there's going to be a healing of the land, and it's going to be a back to the garden kind of an experience. I mean, I can't even imagine how incredible that's going to be. That's what the millennial kingdom will be like. There's going to be a reversal of the curse. Well, number 10. So if you want to spend some time really getting excited about God's plan for us, read through Isaiah 55. Just read through Isaiah. Memorize the book of Isaiah. It's only that much of the Bible. It's, if you're using rice paper, it's only a few hundred pages. Number 10, all of Israel, which is really cool. I think it's already started personally, is going to gather back to Jerusalem to worship. Check that out. All of Israel. And we don't have the time, but do your homework. Since 1948, there have been just thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of Jewish people from all over the world who were scattered there in AD 70 when the temple was destroyed. And there was this great dispersion of the Jewish people all over the world, where they have been persecuted and they have been killed and they have been put into ovens and they have been tried, just under all unbelievable, unprecedented persecution all over the world. Not for a century, not for five centuries, not for a millennia, but for 2,000 years, completely dispersed. One family here, another family there, a group of them here, a village here. I mean, they're just all over the world. And God in 1948 gave them a land, and they all began now to come back to Jerusalem. It's happening right now.
There have been great rescue operations bringing Jews back into Israel from all over the world. And they're continuing to flood in. They're coming back to Jerusalem. I don't know if many of them know it, but they're all part of God's prophetic plan. There's coming a time where all of Israel is going to return to their land for a time of worship. They're going to gather together. Isaiah chapter 11, chapter 27, chapter 43, chapter 49 goes on and on. I'm going to read a little bit of it in Isaiah chapter 11. It's going to happen on that day. Speaking of the millennial kingdom, on that day, that the Lord will again recover the second time with his hand the remnant of his people who remain. The first time, you remember when he took them out of Egypt? When they were in bondage in Egypt, he took them out of there. And now the second time, he's going to bring them out once again and bring them to Israel. And they will remain from Assyria, Egypt, Pathros, Cush, Elam, Shinar, Hamath, and all of the islands of the sea. And he will lift up a standard for the nations and assemble the banished ones of Israel and will gather the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth. And then the jealousy of Ephraim will depart. And those who harass Judah will be cut off, and Ephraim will not be jealous of Judah any longer, and Judah will not harass Ephraim, and they will swoop down on the slopes of the Philistines on the west, and they will gather the plunder of the sons of the east, and they will possess all of this land. And the Lord will utterly destroy the tongue of the sea of Egypt, and he will wave his hand over the river with his scorching wind, and he will strike it into seven streams. I believe this is all not unlike when Israel was taken out of Egypt, they crossed the Red Sea. This will be a time where God is making a way for all of Israel to come back to Jerusalem by land. And so he's striking these massive rivers and making them into little tributaries. He's making a way for them to cross land and get there. And they're going to come back to Israel. Isaiah chapter 27 talks about the same thing. You can read more on those things. Isaiah 43. Number 11. There's sadly, and we talked about this earlier, there's going to be a remnant that are still going to reject Christ and suffer judgment by fire at the end of the millennium. You can read about that in Revelation chapter 20. And they're going to be cast into the lake of fire. So there's going to be this time where Satan is released. Remember, at the end of that 1,000 years, he's going to be released for a short time, and he's going to deceive many. And sadly, there are going to be those, even during the time of the millennial kingdom, that have a choice. And they have to be given a choice, otherwise they're not really choosing righteousness. And so they're given an opportunity, and they will be cast into the lake of fire as well. And we talked about that earlier, so that's a sad part of that. Israel's going to be blessed. They're going to multiply on the earth during that time of the millennial kingdom like nobody's business. They're going to shout with joy at the height of Zion. Jeremiah, the prophet, speaks of this. The Lord's going to turn their mourning into joy, comfort them, give them joy for their sorrow, fill the soul of the priests with abundance. And the Lord declares that he is going to cause them to dance, and they are going to be radiant with the bounty of the Lord, and they are going to multiply. Isaiah 27, they're going to sprout, and they're going to fill the whole world with their fruit. That's a reference to this. They're going to just, you know, continue to propagate in a massive way. And God's going to wipe away their tears, number 13, along with all of the redeemed. I read about that earlier in Isaiah chapter 30, chapter 51. Number 14, God is going to optimize growing conditions. This is really interesting. He's going to optimize growing conditions in Israel, and their harvests are going to be incredibly fruitful. So he's basically saying, everything that I promised you, it's going to come to pass, and it's during this millennial kingdom, and Israel is going to be once again like Eden, if you can imagine that. Israel is going to be like Eden. God is going to bless their land. He already has. I mean, it used to be incredible. It used to be this a desert and a swamp. That's what the land of Israel once was, just a desert and a swamp, you know? And it was just a terrible, terrible land. And in 1948, they began to drain the swamps by planting these, you know, huge eucalyptus trees. It would suck up the water out of these swamps. And they have now this budding, you know, incredible export business of flowers and fruit because the land is so lush and rich. And God is going to bless that. He's going to reverse the curse even in that and prosper their land where he will give them rain for the seed, Isaiah chapter 30, that they have sown in the ground, bread from the yield of the ground. It's going to be rich and plenteous. And on that day, your livestock will graze in roomy pasture, and the oxen and the donkeys which work the ground will eat the salted fodder which has been winnowed with a shovel and fork, and every lofty mountain and every high hill, there's going to be streams of running water. That's Isaiah chapter 30. That's describing that land. It's lush. There's rivers coming out of the mountains. All your animals are going to just live in lush, you know, lots of room and lots of food, and the bread out of the ground, the seed that you sow is going to burst forth with fruit. It's going to be, an incredible, supernatural blessing of the earth. Number 15, and we'll be done, open up for a time of questions, but those who dwell in Zion, will experience physical and spiritual healing and wholeness. There's going to be this health. How about that? How about that business? Huh? Yeah. No more struggles. No more aches and pains and disease and sickness and tumors and all that stuff. You know, that's all part of the curse. Isaiah 33, during the millennial kingdom, it says, and no residents there in Zion is going to say, I am sick. The people who dwell there are going to be forgiven of their sin. Their eyes of the blind are going to be opened. The ears of the deaf are going to be unstopped. The lame will leap like a deer, and the tongue of the mute is going to shout for joy. That's what's going to happen during the millennial kingdom. Number 16, again, the remnant of Israel is going to be honored and a light to the nations. Isaiah 44, Zechariah chapter 9. The Lord is going to save them in that day. They are like stones in his crown that sparkle. And they're going to be blessed. And their offspring are going to be known among the nations, their descendants in the midst of the people. And those who see him will recognize them because they are offspring. I read earlier, Isaiah 61, whom the Lord has blessed. Number 17, the Jesus' eternal kingdom reign, there is no possibility of Israel ever falling away again. I love that. Once the millennial kingdom happens, the time of the great tribulation is over, there's no possibility that Israel is going to fall away yet again. From now on, forevermore, the Lord says in Isaiah chapter 59. So I guess when that time comes where Satan is loosed, all of Israel is going to say, nah, we played that game. The Gentiles, there will be some that fall away at the end of the time of the millennial kingdom when Satan is released. Number 18, the nations of the earth are going to bring treasures to Zion. There was all of those times where Israel was invaded and burned, and all of the temple silver and gold was lugged off to Syria or lugged off to Babylonia and the Babylonian invasion. You know, all of the treasures that were once taken, they're going to be all brought back to Israel. The treasures are going to be brought to Zion. Your gates are going to be open continually. They will not be closed day or night, Isaiah chapter 60, so that men may bring you the wealth of their nations with their kings led in procession. So the kings, the leaders of other nations are going to come to Israel and bring them all kinds of goods and all kinds of treasures and all kinds of resources. For the nation and the kingdom which will not serve you will perish, and those nations will be utterly ruined. But the kings will lead a procession of wealth, bringing it to Israel. Number 19, Jesus is going to be the light. You'll no longer have a need for sun to light the day. For the brightness will the moon give you light. But you will have the Lord for an everlasting light, and your God for your glory. And your sun will no longer set, nor will your moon wane. Number 20, Israel is going to be given a new name. The city of truth, I believe we read earlier out of Isaiah. Number 21, lifespans are going to be longer. There will no longer be infants who live only a few days, or an old man who dies or does not live out his days, for the youth will die at the age of 100. That's the young ones, the young people. during the millennial kingdom. The young ones, if they die, the young ones, they'll die at 100 years old, and people are going to go, well, they must have been accursed. So there's this expansion of life. I believe that's because of the reverse of the curse. And there's a lot of reasons why I believe that. But so where's the church in all of this? We've talked a lot about Israel. There's a few more. I don't have time to go into it. But there's so many great things. But where's the church in all this? We've talked about Israel. We've talked about, you know, the reversing of the curse. We've talked about how Israel is going to be honored and blessed, and the nations, Jesus is going to be in Jerusalem, and all the nations are going to be, you know, want to be there, and all of that. So where is the church in all of this? Well, the church, there's not a lot said about it concerning the millennial kingdom. But what is said about it thrills me to death. And what's said concerning Israel is that in that time of the millennial kingdom we read about a couple of different times out of Revelation, that you and I as the church, here's what we're going to be doing. All of these things during the millennium, or the millennial kingdom, are referring to Israel because it's an earthly kingdom. And God had promised it and promised them this land and promised them all of these things. And that's all going to come to pass. And so there's a lot said about that in the prophets. But in the new covenant, there's not a lot said about what our stance is there in the millennial kingdom. Other than this, we are going to rule and reign with Christ. In Revelation chapter 5, they sang a new song saying, Lord, you are worthy to take the book and open the seals. And you were slain, and you redeemed us to God by the blood and by your blood out of every kindred, tongue, and people, and nation. And you've made us unto our God kings and priests. And it says, Revelation chapter 5, verse 10, and we, that's the church, we shall reign on the earth, or reign over the earth. We're going to reign. We're going to somehow be in a place of reigning with Christ. Revelation chapter 20, again, very specifically concerning the millennial kingdom, it says, blessed and holy is he that has part in the first resurrection. On such the second death hath no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Again, a reference directly to the church. We're going to reign with him for 1,000 years. Well, what does it mean to reign with Christ? I don't know, but I know it's with Christ. I don't know what that's going to look like exactly, but I know it's with Christ. I know that whatever it is going to be so over the top that I'm not going to be like, you know, really? That's all it is? That's what the deal is, Jesus? You said I was going to reign and that's it? No, there will be nobody that takes that position. And I believe that for 2,000 years, the church, the saints of the church, we have lived as strangers and pilgrims on this earth. Much of the church, throughout all of history up till present day, more today than ever, has been ostracized, has been persecuted, has been martyred. The church has the martyrs, the blood of the martyrs to thank for our prosperity as a church. Because wherever the church has been persecuted, the church has grown. If you look through church history, that is a fact. And the church, the saints have been in this incredible place of pilgrimage and strangers in a land. And I believe there's coming a time where God is going to honor that and say, you know what? It's time for prosperity. It's time for unprecedented peace. It's time to rule and reign. You have been stepped on, spit on, kicked around, just like the Jewish people. And I'm establishing my people according to the prophets, and I'm establishing the church in the millennial kingdom to rule and reign. Hebrews chapter 13, we'll read this soon as we're in Hebrews chapter 12 presently. It says, they went forth unto Christ without the camp, bearing his reproach, but now they're going to be richly rewarded. There's coming a time where you and I will be richly rewarded. Can you imagine that? I mean, we read about that in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. where everything that we do that's gold, silver, and precious stones is going to be honorable, and we're going to take that into heaven with us, and God is going to honor and he's going to reward that. And everything that was done that's wood, hay, and stubble, that was not done in love, that was not done with a purpose for the kingdom of God, that's all going to burn away. That's the refiner's fire when Christians enter to heaven. That's the Bema Seat judgment, if you would, or the judgment seat of Christ. And we enter into heaven, and the word says we're going to be rewarded. And God is saying, I believe in Hebrews, man, we went with Christ, we were thrown out the camp, we were bearing his reproach, but now there's coming a time where we're going to be richly rewarded. And I believe that that's going to happen not only in the millennial kingdom, but in the eternal kingdom as well. Romans chapter 8, verse 17, and we'll be done. It says, they suffered with him, but they're going to be glorified together. And so we go through suffering. In this world, we will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. He's overcome the world. And there's coming a time we will rule and reign with him. Romans chapter 8, verse 18, it says, and then will it be fully manifested that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which are going to be revealed in us. There's coming a time where we are going to be glorified. There's coming a time where we are going to be in the presence of God. There's coming a time where we are going to return with him at the second coming of Christ, and the millennial kingdom will enter or will kick off at that point. And during that time, we will rule and reign with Christ. And again, that the scriptures are somewhat silent, except for these things that we just read, concerning exactly what that's going to look like. But I know this, it's going to be unbelievable. It's going to be epic. That's our destiny. That's where we're headed. And then from there, on to the New Jerusalem, on into heaven for that eternal time. Lord, we just bless you. We thank you, Lord, that we have hope. We thank you, Lord, that you've counted us as your own, Lord, that we have the hope of the rapture of the church. We know that your judgment is not for us. We're not children of wrath. We know, Lord, that the saints are going to return with you as you touch your foot down on the Mount of Olives. Lord, as we are ushered into the millennial kingdom, where there's still some fog in our minds, but we know you're doing a great work. We know that all so much of what we've read, Lord, is yet to come to pass, and we're going to be a part of it. We're going to rule and reign with you. It's clear. And no matter what that looks like, we're excited about it. And then on into heaven, and Lord, how that's all going to play out, we don't know exactly, but you've given us some clarity in your word on the general direction of how those things are going to play out. And so, Lord, either way, we're excited. Either way, we're excited to worship you on into eternity. And Lord, we just want to be filled with your Holy Spirit. We want your Spirit to be upon us and empowering us. And we want to do things right and orderly and decently according to your word. And so we pray, Lord, that in this upcoming week, as we're praying about, Lord, more of you and less of us in our life, that, Lord, you'd bring some clarity by your word in what it means to be empowered by the Spirit of the living God. And so bless my friends. Bless your work. Bless your word. In Jesus' name. Everybody said?
Amen.
Amen. God bless you guys. Have an awesome week. We'll see you this weekend.
Hey, I know that you were totally blessed by the word, because the word of God is powerful and it changes us. And so I'm really glad you guys tuned in today. And if you want to continue to maybe hear more about the series that we're in, or you want to just check out some of the other teachings, feel free to go to mtnchurch.tv and you can find all of our teachings posted there. But more importantly, man, I hope that you, if you're in the vicinity at all, you can come and join us live. And come to our services. I'd love to meet you and pray with you. So God bless you, and I hope to see you soon.